Greetings everyone, welcome to commerce classes. So today we'll be discussing paper of financial accounting of BCom honors for semester for the admissions of 2020. Now since this was for the first time that exam was being held in online mode, which is referred as OBE, open book exam in university circles, so it was known that the questions will be more of analytical kind, which will be requiring conceptual knowledge. So let us discuss the paper, and then in the coming video I will be explaining you the solutions of the paper. Now in this paper you have complete 3 hours to solve it and a maximum of 55 marks. You have 4 questions carrying equal marks. So 55 divided by 4, so that is 13.75. So each question is carrying 13.75 marks. Now calculators are allowed, and you are to make proper working notes which will be a part of the answer. So all the solutions along with the working notes are to be done clearly. So there is an open choice, 4 questions out of 6, but we'll be solving all 6. Okay. Now answer to the theory questions should be in brief and to the point. This is a general requirement for any paper. Now your first question is, state with reasons whether the following statements are true or false. Now no marks, so one needs to read very carefully. No marks shall be awarded without valid reason, right? So you have to explain the statement as true or false. So you have to give a valid reason for the same. Without reason, if you are writing it's a true or false statement, that will not get you any marks. So complete 1.5 marks are there for the reasoning, for the correct answer. So you have 5 statements being given. One is that branch account is prepared under debtor system of branch accounting is a nominal account. So now you are to see that when you prepare a branch account under debtor system, why do you prepare it? Is your purpose to find out the balance, or the purpose is something different? Now those who have done this method, they know that purpose of preparing this account is to find out the profit or loss of the branch, because for each branch that the head office is having, they prepare a separate branch account, and at the end the balancing figure is referred as a profit or loss. So the statement which is prepared to find out profit or loss is referred as nominal. So branch account is a nominal account. So this is a true statement, and the reasoning is also there, right? Then another is, fundamental assumptions are always required to be disclosed. So read very carefully. They want, they say that the statements must be disclosed in the financial statements. And we all know that the fundamental assumptions are the basics. They are the, you can say, the foundation of the accounting on which the whole work is done. So these are always there. That is why we call them assumption. These are assumed to be there. So in reality, we don't need to disclose them. These are not to be disclosed. Rather, if we deviate from this, that is, if in some cases you are not following those assumptions, then you need to specify. So this is a false statement. Then change in accounting estimates has to be given with the retrospective effect. Now this is again a false statement, because if there is a change in the accounting estimate, then that shall have to be adjusted in the coming periods. We cannot go back and correct the statements. So as per the accounting standards, this has to be done for the coming period, for the future period. So change in accounting estimates is not to be done with the retrospective effect. So this is a wrong statement, false statement. Another is, economic life is 6 years, lease term is 2.5 years, but the asset is of a special nature and has been procured only for the use of lessee. So is it an operating lease? Now we know that the time period is one of the main concerns when we distinguish between a financial lease and operating lease, right? If the period of the asset is approximately, the period for which you are giving the asset on lease is approximately equal to the life of the asset, then usually it is referred as financial lease. So apparently it seems that it is not a financial lease, but the very fact that this asset is a special asset and has been procured only for the use of lessee, so this gives it a nature of financial lease, because for financial lease there are certain conditions. So if any condition holds true, the lease becomes financial lease, otherwise it is an operating lease. So in the present case, this statement is False. Then change in the method of depreciation is a change in the policy. Again, you remember when we read the accounting standards, if there is a change in the method, this is just the way in which we are allocating the cost of the asset over the life of the asset. So the change in method is not a change in the policy. This is just a change in the estimates or your assumptions for the providing of depreciation. So again, this is a false statement. So we'll do this in detail. I'll explain you all the points. Then another is explain the difference between financial lease and operating lease. It's a 3 marks question. It's a very direct question. You have to define and distinguish between the two type of lease. So very simple. Then explain in brief the relevant accounting assumptions or principles which are applied when you classify the expenses as capital or revenue. So you need to understand what is a capital expenditure and what is a revenue expenditure. Now when you say a capital expenditure, expenditure which is likely to give you a benefit over a longer period of time. So automatically the accounting period assumption, accrual assumption, matching assumption, they come into picture. So these are some of the assumptions which we consider when we classify the expenses into these two. Again, in detail, I'll be explaining you when we are giving the solutions. So right now we are just understanding. So your first question is purely theory, right? And anyone who has understood the chapters, they can easily solve this first question. So it's right. Now the next question is, X purchased 5 machines on 1st October, that is in the middle of the year, if we have financial year being followed. Let us see that. So 5 machines are being purchased from Y. So payment has to be made 20% down and balance in 4 equal annual installments, and each has to be paid at the end of the each year. So you have to pay this at the end of each year. Now each year does not imply here, is it a financial year or the year that is the year from the time from which you are purchasing the asset. So there is some ambiguity in the question paper. And anyhow, so we'll be solving it under both the assumptions. X writes off depreciation at the rate of 20% on the original cost. On his failure to pay third installment, he emailed to X that he will repossess 3 machines. So it's a case of default and repossession, and you will be allowed a credit of value of machine at 40% depreciation per annum or amount paid against 3 machines, whichever is least. Okay, so repossession will be done on the basis of the least of the two. So it's a higher purchase question involving default and repossession, and then after repossession the person spent some amount on the repair of these machines. Again, I'm saying we are to read the fine lines. So you are to repair these machines means all these 3 machines have been repaired at the cost of 6,000. So this is not on one machine, it is on all the 3 machines that you have repossessed, and then one machine has been sold at 70,000. So out of 3, one will be sold. You will be determining its profit or loss, and remaining 2 will be left there with the higher vendor. So you have to prepare the machinery account and higher vendor account in the books of X, higher purchaser account and goods repossessed account in the books of Y, and then you have to show how these items will appear in the balance sheet of X. All right. So higher purchase question. So you have one full question on this. Then you have third question, which is from, so this is, we can say it's a higher purchase accounting chapter which is being given here. Then you have branch accounting question. It's a very delicate question. If you read this question, you will be finding that every point has some, you know, calculations, some understanding. So very concept based question, although it is very unlike to the type of questions that we come across in BCom honors. The standard seems to be more of a, you know, CA kind of thing. Anyhow, let us understand the question. So Om Limited purchased it invoices goods to Mumbai and Kolkata branch. So they have 2 branches. Goods are invoiced at 20% less than the list price, which is cost plus 50%. So in case you have done this chapter very carefully, you know that there are 2 ways of invoicing the things. One is when the cost price and on that basis invoice price is fixed, and which is usually the selling price. Another is that you have 3 prices being there, cost price, invoice price and selling price. So invoice price is is somewhere in between the two. The difference of cost and invoice price is loading. That is the secret profit which is not known to the branch manager, whereas here in this case you have apparent profit. Apparent profit means the profit which is known to the branch manager, and we account for the two separately. I hope you remember the procedures. Okay, so opening stock is given at its cost. So it is the cost of Mumbai. Mumbai is a branch, so branch doesn't know the cost actually. For the branch, invoice is the cost. So in fact, it is the invoice price. Goods sent to Mumbai at cost to Delhi. Delhi is the head office. So if something is costing, you know, to head office, it means it is the cost price. So when you are working for this, you will have to convert it into invoice price. Now cash sales are not directly mentioned. It's a percentage of credit sales. So let us see, if we have credit sales, we can calculate it. Otherwise, we'll have to make some working notes for the same. Goods returned by the customers to Mumbai. Mumbai is a branch. That means goods returned to branch. Because you know, the accounting for goods returned to branch and goods returned to head office is different, so we need to understand it. Goods returned by Mumbai to Delhi, that is goods returned to head office. Then loss of goods by fire, so this is your abnormal loss, right? So abnormal loss is there, invoice price is there, and you are recovering 80% of the cost. So don't make a mistake of recovering 80% of this thing from the company. Okay, you recovered here means that you received the money also. You know, in case of insurance claims, usually, you know, there is a doubt in the minds of the students while solving a question that whether we have got the money or not. So you know, if you have got the money, it is recovered. If you haven't got the money, then the term or the language which is used here is that 80% claim is accepted. It means claim is accepted, but payment hasn't been done. But now payment has also been recovered. This is the general meaning of this question. Then you have loss of normal pilferage at list price. Now remember, this is a list price. So list price or selling price. So you will have to adjust it to invoice and then to cost for all your working. So you have a normal loss also. Then you have debtors, opening and closing balance, cash remitted, and remittances are given, right? Discount to debtors, goods received by Mumbai branch till close of the year. Now, you know that when you have goods received as well as goods sent, it gives rise to goods in transit. So you need to measure this also, isn't it? Then you have provision is to be made for discount on debtors at 15% of the prompt payment. So you will have to see how much is the prompt payment, how many persons actually, you know, pay you promptly, and accordingly, according to the trend of prompt payments, you will be providing for discount. So that will have to work out. Cash remitted by head office to branch for expenses. So in case of dependent branches, head office sends cash, right? So you are given cash sent to branch for expenses. Expenses outstanding are your, it's a closing balance. And when you are to prepare P&L account, as we are asked in this question, then we record expense of the year. P&L account is prepared on accrual basis. So you will be adding the two to calculate expense of the year. So, you know, this adjustment is also there. Then you have manager is entitled to a commission at the rate of 6% of the net profits. So after charging the commission, so there is a point of commission also. So you see, the whole question is very concept based, and every statement I'll say that involves one or the other kind of calculation. So you are to prepare debtor account, stock account, adjustment account, expense account, and P&L account. So your debtor account is of 2 marks. Stock and adjustment account, you know, these are the two main accounts which form the base of calculation of profit. So these are of 4 marks each. Then your expense account is simple, you know, calculation of expenses, total expenses of 1 mark, 2.5 for P&L. So this is how your amount is spread. So we can say that till now we have one complete question from higher purchase and one complete question from the branch. Now next question is your partnership. So you are to present this in theory, state two circumstances under the which the rule of Garner versus Moraes cannot be applied. Okay, so you are to look into the rules. like what are the cases when this rule cannot be applied, then state the basic assumptions in MPL and proportionate capital method of piecemeal distribution, and thirdly, when is it equitable to distribute cash in the profit sharing ratio, okay, without taking care of the two methods. So you have first part of 2 marks, okay, and then you have this first part is of 2 marks, then you have the second part, basic assumptions of 2 marks, and when is it equitable, this is of 1 mark. So 5 marks theory completely from dissolution. Then you are given another question of dissolution regarding piecemeal distribution. X, Y, Z are partners sharing profits and losses. You have these assets. Cash at bank is given. So rest of the assets will be realized and bank is distributed right in the beginning. Then you have two liabilities which are secured on certain assets. We know that in case of liabilities being secured on a particular asset, then they will be paid or they will be having a right to get preferential payment out of the realizations of these assets only. That is, when you sell off building, then bank loan will be paid preferentially out of that amount. But without that, if you are selling some other asset, maybe you know you are selling say machinery, then bank loan doesn't have a preferential right. So you will be distributing that money in the all the three liabilities, right? Similarly, stock is given as a security for Mrs. X loan. So when you sell off stock, then this loan will be given preference for payment. Any balance left will be distributed in the remaining liabilities. We know that payment method, that amounts being realized are to be paid in the order of preference and in proportion. So preference is there, but it is only on the relevant assets, okay? Then you have two partners liabilities, second party liabilities, and then you have capital plus reserves. Reserve is distributed to find out the capital claim of the partners. So you are to apply the available cash along with the future realizations. Expenses are to be deducted alongside we are given, okay? So you will first use this money to pay these liabilities, then partners loans, and then partners capital. But before this, you know that we are to make provision for any contingent liabilities, and maybe you are to keep some cash provisions as per the question. So your question says that there is a bill of 50,000 due on 15th August. That means up to 15th August, we need to keep a provision for contingent liability. All right. And if at the same time, on 15th August, if the acceptor of the bill pays the amount, then this money is released and we can use it to pay our liabilities. If the person doesn't pay or partially pays, then accordingly we will utilize the money and balance left will be used by the firm to pay the remaining liabilities. So these are all your your realizations. Now here in X is taking over a machine, so if a partner takes over a asset, we'll give it to him and then we'll be redistributing the money as per the method that we are following. Now in case a partner takes over the asset, there are two ways to adjust this. One is that under MPL method, what we do is that we give the asset as it is. We can give the asset as it is to the partner. Because after this also, for each realization, we calculate maximum possible loss, we distribute it among partners. So even if a partner has taken over some asset, the amount will automatically be adjusted, because when you calculate MPL and you calculate the remaining balance due, the adjustment will be done therein. Okay, but in case we are following proportionate capital method, under this method what we do is that if a partner is taking over an asset, since we have already decided the proportionate payments, that who is to be paid, whether you are to pay to X, Y, Z, whosoever is in the preferential order, accordingly that asset will be given. So we will simply record that we are making payment in kind, right? Like he is taking over asset of say 55 lakh. Now as per the say a preference order, X is to be paid say 60 lakhs. So we will say that out of 60 lakhs, 55 is for the asset and 5 is in the cash. Okay, so this is how we can do this. Now, if the amount is lesser, maybe in place of 60, he is to be paid 50 lakhs. So you will say that we will pay him You can say that we will pay him asset of 55 lakh, and for the 5 lakh rupees of extra payment, we will be finding out how much should be paid to Y and Z in proportion. So X will be paid this amount in kind in form of asset, but accordingly Y and Z will be paid a proportionate amount in advance, right? So this is how the proportionate capital system works. Then you are to keep a minimum cash balance. So you are to keep a cash provision up to May, and then 25,000 thereafter. So up to May means we can say up to end of May we'll be keeping this provision, and after that we'll release 25,000 out of that, and 25,000 will be kept as a provision. And at the end, you know, when last installment is distributed, we don't need this provision any further, so this will be added in the cash. And acceptor paid the amount on the due date, that means on 15th of August, this provision will also be released. We don't need this money. So you have a complete question from the chapter partnership. So if we look at our paper structure, what we find is that there is a complete question from branch of 13.75 marks. There is a complete question from higher purchase. There is a complete question from dissolution. Okay, now next is a question on stock. So Rajasthali Limited manufactures a product using a raw material. Company took a bank overdraft specially for the purpose of purchasing the material at this price. Purchase price includes GST, in respect of which full credit is admissible. That is, you are eligible to take the credit. Now remember, whenever we are buying, you know, raw material or any asset, we need to remember when the GST is admissible, then this is not included in the cost of the asset. So you will be deducting this 10 rupees from the price. Please remember this. Because when GST is paid and we take full credit for the same, then this will not be added in the value of the material, because you are getting the credit. So this is not your cost. Okay. Then you have freight, loading, unloading charges, interest on bank overdraft. Normal loss is 2%, but your company received 9760 kilograms. So you have got a normal loss. Now, if we say that we have 10,000 kilogram of raw material, normal loss of 2%, that is 200, we should have received 9,800 kilogram of raw material, but we received 9,760. That means you have got an abnormal loss of 40 kilograms. Now, some of us may, we may argue that the loss is barely 0.4%. So why should this be taken as abnormal loss? Now usually, you know, when we specify a boundary of normal loss, the normal loss is going to be 2%, then anything beyond that will be treated as abnormal, right? This is our accounting standard requirement. Now, 1 unit of finished product requires 5 units of raw material. Okay, so now you are producing a finished product using 5 units of raw material. So let us see how many units are produced. So you have labor cost, you have overheads, you have total fixed overheads of the year also on this capacity. Now the capacity is immaterial. When you have fixed overhead, these are fixed. It means these will be taken as it is whether we produce these many units or not. During the year, sales were of these many at 750. Now it means that you have sold 1000 units. Okay, sale is there, and there was no opening inventory. And with reference to AS2, calculate abnormal loss, calculate closing stock and finished goods and raw material. If finished units can be sold at 800, so we are given the selling price with the commission. Replacement cost of raw material is also given, and in the second case also we are given the selling price and we are given the price of raw material. We know that in case of inventories we follow LCM rule, that is lower of cost or market. Market here means net realizable value. So out of the two, whichever is least is taken as the price, okay, for the valuation of inventories. So we'll be measuring the closing stock. Now the question says that we have sold 1000 units. So how many units are left as a closing stock, or what was the total production? So we are given we consumed 9500 kilograms. So if you consumed 9500 kilogram and you use 5 kilogram per unit, it means you have 1900 units being produced. Since there was no opening stock and you sold 1000 units, your closing stock will be 900 units. So a measurement of closing stock is there. Now you know this question, when you look at this question, although it's not a difficult question to handle, if we know the concept of cost, it can be done. But my personal opinion is that this is you know, not falling within the prescribed syllabus. You are given three methods of inventory valuation: FIFO, LIFO and weighted average. But therein, you know, they we are not required, we are not asked to do this NRV method. Anyhow, still it can be handled. Okay, so you have got inventory of 6 marks. Then now a second part of this question is regarding depreciation. Okay, so you have machinery being purchased on 30th of September. Price is given after charging GST and a trade discount on the quoted price. So this is the net price. You know, in this GST is included and trade discount is subtracted. Transport charges are 0.25% of the quoted price, so we need to calculate quoted price. So we need to make calculations. Installation charges again 1%, so we'll calculate this. To finance the purchase of the machine, company took a bank loan of 500 lakhs. So you have interest on loan and other component, fee of consultant, cost of site preparation. So all the points, all the components are given here. You know, when you go through the standard, all the relevant components which are there are given here also. So expenditure on the trial run. So when you have a trial run, the cost is capitalized. So you are able to sell the goods also. So the net cost of the trial run will also be capitalized. Now, machine was ready to use on 1st December. Now, this is a very important point. When our asset becomes ready for use, then from that date onwards, we are to take up the cost of the asset. So all the relevant costs will be capitalized on this date. So when you have an interest on loan, interest will be, you know, it will be there on the time basis till the time you have the loan with you. But the interest up to 1st December will be capitalized, but not beyond that. Okay, then entire loan is still unpaid, so that doesn't matter to us, because we'll capitalize it only up to 1st of December. Beyond that, it will be a normal expenditure. Okay, financial cost of the business. Now, X doesn't intend to utilize the input tax paid on the capital goods. This is a very important point. When you pay the GST in case of capital goods, you can either claim that as a credit. So, in your tax returns, you can claim this as credit, or you can capitalize this. So, in this problem, since the person doesn't want to utilize the input tax credit, so he can always capitalize the amount. So in the value of the asset, GST will be included. So we are to calculate the cost of the asset, and then we are to give the accounting treatment of the cost incurred during the period between the date when the machine was ready for use and the actual date. When your asset is ready to use, beyond that, all expenses will be taken as recurring expenses. This is what we can see. Now, third part is Sheena Limited acquired machine on lease on the following terms. Lease term is 5 years, fair value is 15. Fair value of machinery is 30 lakhs with the life of 15 years. So we can easily see that neither the you know, the lease payments, which are comprising of 10 lakh, right? 15 lakh, sorry. So the total payment is of 15 lakh, so it is nowhere near the fair value of the asset. Similarly, the life of the asset is also not equal to, approximately equal to the lease term. implicit rate of return is given, state with the reason whether the lease is operating or financial lease. So we know that in case of financial lease, there are certain conditions like the lease term should be approximately equal to the life of the asset, lease payments in all should be approximately equal to fair value of the asset, or the asset has been specifically purchased for the person. So these are certain conditions. None of these hold true here. So this can be referred as operating lease. Now we are given present value factors, but we don't need them. In case of operating lease, these are not needed. So what will be the amount of depreciation? So who will charge the depreciation? Depreciation will be charged by the lessor. And what will be the amount of rental expenditure in the first year? So that will work out in as the method of operating lease suggests. So this is of 1.75 marks and this first part is of 2 marks. So it's similar to the theory question, because you are just to explain all those points and then you are to negate that none of the conditions are satisfied, so it is a operating lease. Okay, so you have, you know, here in a question of inventory, another of depreciation, and another of this thing, lease. Okay, 3.75 marks. Now, next is a trial balance of a company is given, extracts are given. So, some information is given. Then we are given the additional information, like for the stock, we are given that stock taking was completed on 7th April and following the transactions, and transactions are given. So, we'll have to calculate closing stock on 31st of March of the year 2020. So we know how to come back, right? So from 7th of April, we'll have to get back to 31st March. If we take up this as, yes, see, this is the 31st of March 2020, and here in the stock taking has ended on 7th April. So we know the stock on this date. So for this particular period, stock, this can be referred as closing stock and this can be referred as opening stock. So considering the transactions that have taken place during this period, we will be calculating opening stock using our own general formula. Then goods were taken by the proprietor, then you had goods given as a sample, goods destroyed by fire, that is abnormal loss, you have a claim, then goods sent on sale or return basis, which is recorded as actual sale. So you have a lot of errors here coming up, and we are to then investments were sold, but these are included in the sales. So you can say that we'll be adjusting all these things and we'll be calculating as per the question. We'll calculate the amount of sales or purchases. As the question says, calculate closing stock. Closing stock will be measured, net sales, net purchases. So this is net purchase, this is net sale. Then you have information relating to machinery. You have some errors coming up. 25,000 paid for repairs in 2019-20, that is in the last year, on this 2017 it has been capitalized. Then another 45,000 being the cost of machinery purchased was written off as wages, and installations were also debited to wages. So there are two errors coming up which we need to rectify. Then currently a machine was purchased on 1st July. Wages paid for its installation are debited. So not only a new purchase is there, but we have the error of recording also. So we need to correct the errors. Rate of depreciation is given. So what is expected out of us? We are to calculate the amount of closing capital. Okay, so closing capital and the closing balance of plant and machinery and balance of debtors, as we are given for debtors, right of bad debts, right of additional discount, then you have provisions, you know, so all these adjustments are given. Then you have a common debtor and creditor point also. A JED is a person who is to pay you 1,000 and who is to from whom you will be recovering 3,000. So out of 3,000, 1,000 is common. So that will be adjusted or taken care of while calculating provisions, etc. So we can say that it's a very complex question, complete question involving a whole lot of adjustments with, you know, just 2 marks of plant and machinery. You have got so many adjustments. two errors in the previous years which are to be adjusted, one error in the current year which is again to be adjusted, right? So you have a whole lot of adjustments being required. Similarly, in the purchase sale also, you have, you know, purchase, net purchases, net sales of 2 marks, 2 marks, 2 marks, but you have a whole lot of adjustments coming up here. So, in all, you can say that it's a very conceptual paper, very different from what has been there in the preceding years. It's a very good paper. If we have laid the, you know, foundation right from the beginning in the meetings and in the paper guidelines. So, in all, what we find is that though it's a very conceptual paper, you have a complete question of 13.75 marks coming from branch. You have a question from higher purchase, and you have a question of same, you know, 13.75 from dissolution. You have a question from final accounts again of 13.75. Then you have a question of depreciation, inventory, and another question of lease. So depreciation is of 4 marks, inventory is of 6 marks, and this lease is of 3.7 marks. Then you have initially a theory question which involves, you can say, true-false questions of 7.5 marks. Then you have a lease question, okay, and then you have another question of 3.7, which is again a theory question based on accounting principles. Okay, so this is a general theory. So in all, if we are to attempt, you know, 4 questions, so considering the previous, you know, papers, the standard has been up. And to some extent, my personal feeling is that the bifurcation of the marks as given in the syllabus, as given in the meetings, is not taken care of while drafting this. Though it's a very good conceptual paper. Anyhow, so we'll be solving this paper in the coming video. So that is going to be a very long video because we'll be solving all the 6 questions. And you know, if we expect our students to solve 4 questions, you know, in 3 hours, so I'll be solving the complete 6 questions, and let us see how much time it takes. So we'll club all the solutions together, so it will be a very long video. So thank you for the day. I hope you have understood the kind of paper that we have in this year, and given the insight about the adjustments, etc., I hope you have done the paper fairly well. Thank you.